I'm Jean Carlson, and I'm a professor of physics at UC Santa Barbara, and I'm a member of the external faculty at Santa Fe Institute.
I'm Mercedes Pascual, a professor at the University of Chicago, and I'm also an external member here at the Santa Fe Institute, and I'm co-chairing the board. So the title of our working group is Age Adaptation, the Arrow of Time in Infectious Diseases. So we are trying to understand how the immune system responds to infectious diseases and how it breaks down in its responses to infectious diseases with age. And a simple way to see age is to think there is an absolute age in how this your response would vary, how it would fail. And that is not the case. There is tremendous heterogeneity in individuals, in individuals within a population, within a species. And not just individual variability, but there is an increased variability in the response when you age. And there seems to be possibly some tipping points in your capacity to respond. So one of our main aims is, I believe, to understand that heterogeneity better.
Mm-hmm. There's a concept of complex time that the overall working groups are all trying to address that really comes somehow from the life history. So one of the things that we're trying to understand in our working group is how the life history of individuals impact their age, their biological age or immunological age, or even a population's aging processes as a whole through epidemiology.
Well, I think the first meeting was in large part to get a community of people that do not necessarily work together, that come from different disciplines, including immunology, epidemiology, some theoreticians, some more empirical people. So to bring these people together to define what could be some areas, some key areas that we can work on, right? And so we identify some of those areas. Maybe we can summarize some of those. And one seemed to be the interaction of the innate and specific immune system and the dynamics of this. So generally, at least in the typical models in epidemiology, we may consider the specific response, the specific memory to what you have been exposed to. But there is also another branch of the immune system that has to do with inflammation, with more general responses. And these two parts interact, and they seem to differ in their importance as you age. And somewhat this balance of their interaction seems to have a lot to do with the failure of your response, right? So I think we identify that as a major area, in particular for developing basic modeling framework to approach, to understand this. That was one major area. Another was, how can we take that kind of model that may be conceived for humans and basically scale it to apply it to other species. Another area is the problem that the immune system sees different pathogens and even different variants of same pathogen. Let's say the flu virus this year was not the same as last year, etc. Now, if you need to understand how the immune system responds, then you have to have a concept of how different those viruses are, but from the perspective of the immune system. There is a problem there because what we have been using have been ways of thinking of distances between pathogens. But we know that there are histories of exposure, phenomena that have to do with age, that break down that concept of distance. So we identify that as a problem because we use these maps that place different pathogens in a map where a distance has a meaning, and basically that breaks down with some of these aging exposures that may vary between individuals. So conceptually, how we then think about distance, antigenic distance, a distance that makes sense for what I have seen and what my new exposure is. So we are thinking about that. So those are some examples of main problems we identify or open areas we identify. So those, I think in the first meeting, a lot of our discussions.
So I think that in the first meeting, it brought a lot of people together. And for me, it was a real chance to learn what's out there, what the data is. But I think another thing that we learn also as a group or identify as a group is that this idea of age is not one that has been addressed. It needs new ideas, new concepts, new models. And a lot of our information, say, about how the, you know, innate immune system reacts to something may be focused on problems like septic shock, you know, in the hospital. Are you going to die? Are you going to live? And it's not something that necessarily has been built previously to look at progressive problems over time. So you might look at the flu this year, but then how does whether you had the flu this year impact next year and the year after over long time periods? So this notion of trying to examine infectious diseases from the point of view of the host or from the point of view of the pathogen is something that is really requires some new science and also requires this multidisciplinary approach of bringing in people that have been looking at different parts of the problems from different perspectives. So one of the things that my group has done is work with another group that was here at the first meeting, on some problems that were identified by yet another person at the first meeting, and to try to build a model that would really speak to this interaction between the innate immune system and the adaptive immune system. So there's two things that happen as you age. One is that your adaptive immune system, which is the part that basically holds on to memory, what were your previous infections, and so on, will tend to specialize with age. So this notion of specialization and over-specialization is called immunosenescence. And so that's an aging effect in that part of the immune system. Meanwhile, in the innate immune system, which is the part that's responsible for things like inflammation and actually telling the adaptive immune system that it's time to go and recognizing that there's a pathogen in there to begin with, that part with age will tend to develop an extreme inflammatory response. And so bringing these two models together and figuring out how to make them interact with each other, what are the key interactions that are important to capture these two processes with age and those interactions and how they drive each other is something that we've built and then brought back to the meeting this time to be informed more by data and get some more input by other members of the working group. So one of the things that my group did after the first meeting is that we started a collaboration with Shenshen Wang from UCLA, who was also at the first meeting, to address some challenge questions that were identified initially by Andrea Graham from Princeton, who's also at the first meeting and is here again. And really the challenge was to bring together the interaction of the innate and the adaptive immune system, which have, you know, in the past been modeled as separate compartments. You do one or the other, and really they're collaborators. So in terms of any sort of disease dynamic, it's really the innate system that comes in at the beginning and then the adaptive system comes in with high specificity ultimately to clear the pathogen. Now, both of these systems have fragilities with age. And with the innate system, it's a tendency towards increased inflammation with age, which is called inflammaging. With the adaptive system, as you build more and more memory to past infections, there's a phenomenon called immunosenescence, which is over-specialization. And so we brought these models together and showed how the interactions drive these transitions from one model to the other. And now we've come back to the meeting this time with a model that has some predictive power, but now we'd like to tune it more towards experiments that have been identified, data from the meeting, and also cross-check with some of the other members of the working group about other interactions that may be of interest.
Another area we have been working this time in this workshop is taking some specific models we have developed for malaria, the joint transmission dynamics of malaria, and the diversification of the pathogen to understand malaria in very high transmission regions, in the very, very endemic regions where it's very, very difficult to intervene because there is enormous diversity. So, yeah, in my lab we have been working with this in the past, but what we have been doing here and what I had been doing in between the two meetings was to try to understand in collaboration with André de Ros, who is here now visiting the Santa Fe Institute, who comes from the University of Amsterdam, to try to understand how we can take this very complex model and simplify it to make it a model we can really use in epidemiology, but that still takes into account the diversification of the pathogen. So most simpler epidemiological models of malaria do not may have age as a variable, but do not have explicitly the pathogen diversity represented. And of course, with age, one has acquires more exposure, etc. So how do we consider that in the context of how diverse the pathogen is and how intervention affects this diversity, which is something completely absent of how we think about intervention. So we would like to have to look at that problem, and in between these meetings we have found that the more complex model has some very interesting behavior as you reduce transmission intensity in terms of how the diversification of the pathogen changes. And we would like to see if a simpler model that we can use for more practical purposes can still capture that kind of sharp transition in diversity and presumably help us better understand the intervention. So that is another example of work that has been going on in between.
So the character of the second meeting is really different from the first meeting. The first meeting was kind of a get-to-know-you meeting where we all introduced ourselves and our work and identified new directions. This meeting is structured as a working group. And what that means is that we have some, you know, we've introduced a few new people and we are presenting work that has occurred in the gap between the two meetings, but most of our time is being spent working in a more focused way on specific projects and moving this research area forward. So to that end, we've had discussions that go into a lot more depth in data for specific animal models and humans. We've sat down and thought in our particular case about this model that we've developed and how we might better, you know, parameterize it in order to make it a predictive and useful model to be able to understand therapeutic and diagnostic tests, and so it's structured in that way.
Yeah, I think at this meeting there are also convergences mm-hmm. of some of these different efforts mm-hmm. because you describe your model, but for example, the people thinking about how you represent the variation of the of a given virus, for example, a given pathogen relative to each other, that can feed into your model. Mm-hmm. And we also had discussions of how to use this model to understand a set of important questions in epidemiology. Mm-hmm. So what kinds of questions? And we also had a discussion about how we can summarize where we are in this field and what are open areas. That would be more what kind of paper we can all write together. So, well, as Jean said in this second meeting, there was more specific work, interactions also between the different efforts and so on. And we can think of those different efforts in some subsets of areas, right? And so you mentioned one, which is that big model that couples these two branches of the immune system. There was a group discussion, a very interesting group discussion of how do we now use this model to better understand questions in epidemiology and how do we go about this, how we can use some data set in the data sets in the literature to approach these questions. So that was one area. Another group focused on how to take basically develop this kind of model for different, as I said before, different species, in particular in relation with how to scale interactions with size. So Andy Dobson and Chris Kempes were leading that. There was an interesting group that was working on this problem of characterizing the distance between the variation in a given pathogen. This question of this so-called antigenic map, was it possible to do this in the context of some of the problems with absolute age not being the relevant age. Mm-hmm. So in particular, there is something called antigenic sin, by which your exposure early in life sort of channels the response mm-hmm. later on. So that that creates many problems with using the kinds of antigenic maps in an absolute sense that you can, in an absolute sense of a given distance between two pathogens. So there was a group that really worked hard at how to think about these problems of antigenic sin, also called imprinting, and so on, which basically makes your response a matter of when you were born. So this becomes a cohort effect and not anymore an absolute age. And so there was a group working on that problem, and if we cannot represent variation of the pathogens in that way, then how do we go about this? And in particular, what kind of data we can use to look for other representations. So that was another group. There was a group, mostly myself, Andrea Ross, a postdoc of mine, working on the problem of the malaria immune escape and epidemiology. And what I would call essentially models for pathogens with extreme antigenic diversity. So extreme that you suffer infections at all ages, and basically almost everyone can be infected in a population. So asymptomatically. So that is very interesting for a whole set of pathogens, not just of humans. So that was another group. And then you maybe, trajectories. So maybe you want to talk about trajectories.
So one of the things is a lot of what we're talking about here is over time and human lifetime and long times, but there's also really interesting effects having to do with the dynamics within a disease. So understanding within the course of a disease, you know, the age-like effect that may be occurring and how it depends, how it varies for different species. There's some exciting new data coming out that looks at you know, mapping out these trajectories and characterizing these trajectories, and we can begin to think about how they depend on age as well. So how to reduce high dimensional data sets to come up with a clock for a disease that is not a time, but rather is a clock that traces through from health to sickness to recovery.
And this essentially how those trajectories, individual trajectories, become predictable mm-hmm. of what your fate may be. I mean, what distinguishes the trajectories that experience recovery mm-hmm. from those that do
exactly.
not.
Diagnostics.
So this is very much based on a very rich data set by David Snyder mm-hmm. from Stanford University, who has been working with experimental systems in mice mm-hmm. infected with malaria, mm-hmm. for example. And so there is a rich data set of many, many measurements mm-hmm. in terms of physiological responses, metabolism, and so on. And he has interesting ideas about how to represent these trajectories, but how to separate the ones that have different fates is something that we are looking into.
And it's not a snapshot, so it's something that's a time-evolving system, and it propagates, you know, something that's elevated at one time may trigger something else happening later and later and later. So there's a data question of how do you represent it, how do you make something like that useful, that actually has a translation into areas like personalized medicine, where you're not always showing, you know, the snapshot of how you are when you walk into the doctor may not be the full, you know, measure of your actual health at a given point in time. So coming up with tools, even just from the point of view of data analysis, is a challenge as well that we're taking. One of the you know, challenge questions for human health is really understanding the wide diversity in outcomes. And this is something that becomes especially prominent with age. As people age, there's this the diversity of outcomes or heterogeneity of outcomes goes from something that's relatively narrowly focused to all of a sudden being a big spread. And the way that we've been talking about this in the group is like an upside down elephant, where you go from you know, early, you know, birth through a period of you know, sort of declining resistance, and up through, as you build immune memory, up through a sort of level back of the elephant time where your health is and resistance is fairly high, and it's also fairly focused. But once you get to later in life, there's this decline overall, but an incredible spread emerges. And one of the things that we're excited about in this model is that it's already showing that effect. The combination of the innate and the adaptive model shows it in a sort of a theoretical and abstract way. And really, though, the challenge for human health and precision medicine is to come up with ways that might mark how far are you from that point of decline in the tail, and where do you sit in this range of diversity. And so what we're hoping to do by bringing together really informed representations of parameters and shape space and interaction, you know, history dependent effects in immune response and epidemics, is to really flesh out what might be predictive aspects from the point of view of human health.
Yeah, I was going to say this in a slightly different way, but pretty much the same, that if age is not a good predictor, of course, mm-hmm. it is in a very generic sense, but not in a very informative way. So, you know, the arrow of time would be for us finding, if it's not age that we should be looking at, what should we be measuring to sort of scale age in a way that then you can tell for an individual, in a sense, how old they are with respect mm-hmm. to this picture of your response to infection. And so that would be like finding how to measure mm-hmm. the arrow of time. I would mm-hmm. say that would be one of the most interesting outcomes. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
Yeah. But so how does your disease trajectory impact your age.
Your age your in age terms of your ability to respond to disease, exactly. So to infectious disease. So that is on the conceptual realm, of course, with many interesting possible applications, right? On a more practical level, I think we will hope to write a review paper that would be a perspective paper, so that it's not just reviewing what we know, but mm-hmm. where we would like to go, what are the open areas. And to write this as a group, right? Mm-hmm. So we have already, I guess, divided the work, and so that is one outcome. The other is, of course, some of this work will result into research papers, mm-hmm. right? That we hope to write that mm-hmm. With new results. Mm-hmm.